there, and welcome to Central Texas Gardener. I'm Tom Spencer. Through our gardens, we create art outdoors. Inside, we can preserve that expression for lasting memories of nature's artistry. Today, the mom and son team behind Flat Flower Cards explains how they got started with handmade botanical greeting cards. Donna and Andy also have a few tips on how to create your own indoor art. On tour, let's visit a garden that finds expression in sun and shade.
You'll find a few tricks in this garden, like the fake lantern to disguise a utility box. Others include how Sue and Mike Nazar designed for too much shade in one area and too much sun in another, in a neighborhood overrun with deer. For Sue, the real trick was getting started.
When we bought this house, we came from a very humble home over by the university, just got out of college, and moved over here. Both were quite in the fast lane. We were making a lot of money, and we bought a house and just told somebody to landscape it and then went off to work. So we did a lot of Asian jasmine, a lot of very normal, what everyone else was doing at the time, kind of landscaping. And about 15, 17 years later, I turned and looked at what was there and went, egads, oh my God, what's happening here?
Some of the deer-proof crown cover remains with a few updates, but since her epiphany, Sue has gradually created layers and levels of garden.
I just take little areas each year and kind of say, what could I do here? What could I do there? What do I feel like learning about?
Along a promenade, Sue gathered transplants a friend dug up when she had to leave her own garden. They were just right for the shady walkway that's a thoroughfare for wildlife, too.
Some of the beautiful things about this area happened to be that we are right on a green belt, and that also brings challenges. There's lots of wildlife that come in and like to mess around in areas.
Through trial and error, Sue discovered other textures and colors that brighten the space without disappearing overnight.
I have about 4 or 5 different varieties of gingers in there, and they flourish. They're a great shade plant. They bring so much texture, so much color, and they work with the wildlife. None of the wildlife like them. I'll have armadillo in there doing their rooting, and actually it's kind of good for the ginger to have a little bit of tilling going on at the root level.
Beyond is a drainage easement, Mike's latest renovation project. With boulders he hauls into a range, he's giving it a new look while fending off erosion. They even created a stone path, hoping the deer would get the point and follow it to forage along the greenbelt. But no, they prefer to follow in Sue and Mike's footsteps through the garden, maybe for inspiration, since not for food.
I have a personal relationship with a 10-point buck that comes out here periodically to come visit me. He's not very intimidated by me, but we have an agreement most of the time.
He doesn't get invited in back, where the fenced yard allows vegetables to grow in safety. Sue can also have roses, arranged in sparse pockets of sun, along with others that need its rays to thrive. A clamoring floral archway stages the entrance to another arena of Sue's gardening persona. In the outdoor family room, she experiments with container design. Beyond the center of family entertainment, she arranged contemplative spaces. She also rearranged her life.
I don't know if you've ever had that happen where you start one day and the next day you're so enthusiastic you can't stand it, and you're just all of a sudden, rather than being a shopaholic, I'm a nurseryholic. I'm going there, checking out what's there, reading all the labels, and just using that as my pastime.
The pastime led to a new career as a garden designer, after she took classes, worked in nurseries, and became a master gardener.
The Master Gardener program is a program that really helps to round you out. It taught me a lot about just the nature of how to build from the ground up any kind of microclimate that I could possibly want.
One microclimate is in front, her only chance of full sun. Here, she created a bed to play with new textures in a border shared with her neighbors. Then, her new life led her straight to the streets.
The area that's right by the sidewalk, between the street and the sidewalk, I call it the Hell Strip, has always been an enigma to me and to all of my neighbors. Basically, we start out at the beginning of every spring with a lot of greenery there, and then by early summer, all that little St. Augustine just kind of dies off. I chose about an 8-foot strip just to play with, and I tore it all out, took the dead St. Augustine out, and put in some good draining soil and started putting some plants that I thought might be deer resistant.
She mixes in herbs and other aromatics that the deer avoid to confuse them and deter their nibbling on favored snacks.
My neighbors noticed what I was doing and kind of nodded at me that it would be really okay with them if I just kept going down that hell strip towards their home. So I took another 8-foot the next year, and then another 8-foot the following year, and now the neighbors next to my neighbors are asking, could I keep going?
To prep for a garden tour, she installed plant tags, planning to remove them later. Then she discovered that the neighborhood's walkers were making notes on their tour de curb.
It's been really wonderful to watch these people strolling and actually staying and spending time here, just studying and learning from my garden.
Thank you so much for sharing your garden with us. And now we're going to stroll down memory lane in the form of some beautiful art. Art created from the garden. I'm joined by Andy and Donna Hammer, who've been guests on the program in the past. Thank you so much for coming back to Central Texas Gardener. It's great to have you.
Yeah, thank you.
You have created a whole line of products, from beautiful cards to original artwork that are pressed botanicals arranged beautifully so that people can frame them or exchange them as gifts. And to me, this speaks of kind of an old-fashioned art form. You know, recently I inherited one old family Bible, and as I was looking through it, I kept finding pressed flowers and four-leaf clovers and things like that. And this really speaks to me to that, Donna. How did you get interested in doing this?
Probably much the same way. I would begin finding old flowers and leaves in my Bible and some of my old books. And I've always had a fascination for just plant life in general, and mm-hmm. somehow I seem to know the names of things. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't have to work at it at all. And so about 15 years ago, I started actually pressing and doing framed pieces just for my own pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how it got started for me. And then when Andy came back to Texas after he had been living out of state for a long time, we decided to go into business and use this vehicle as our primary product in a store that Andy had opened.
Well, and what makes these unique is not that they're just pressed botanicals, but they're so artfully arranged on the page that they really do seem like works of art. Andy, is that your role in this, or how?
It's both of ours, but from what I had seen just through the years, I was seeing a certain style of mm-hmm. botanicals. It was either more scientific purposes or more artsy, but a little more like an older taste mm-hmm. than maybe I had.
Right.
So I think we started bringing what could be a younger taste to it. I'm not sure if mm-hmm. you want to call it that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think we're getting an artful look to them.
Well, I certainly think so. And we have some examples here now. We have one right next to me that it's of a hydrangea. Mm-hmm. And absolutely beautiful. And this is actually an illustration of something new for you. You have lots of originals where you have the actual botanical behind a frame.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But this is a print of a botanical, and it's so well done, you can kind of fool people. You have to really look at this to see that it's a print.
You do. You want to touch it to make sure that it's not 3D.
Right.
At art shows, we have had people come up and feel for
right.
the plant, you know.
Right, right.
And we will say that is actually a print.
Right. Well, but it does have a real three-dimensional object in there, and that you've included in some of these string and other kinds mm-hmm. of things. Now, what's the process, I have to ask, for achieving such fine results in the print?
Well, of course, you have to begin with Mother Nature and mm-hmm. her beauty, and we gather, harvest her plants, most of them from our yards, mm-hmm. but every now and then, if I don't have what we need, we can go purchase it. Or I'm from a big family. I have a brother in Oregon, and I have a son, his brother in St. Louis, and brother in Maine. So they're all kind enough to press things for us and send them to us.
So you get things from all around the country.
All over mm-hmm. the country.
That's
right.
Great. Well, you not only have these prints, which are matted and available for sale, and we'll talk about where in just a moment, but also, and I've seen these all around town now, mm-hmm. Beautiful cards that people can buy and share as gifts or keep and frame themselves, because the cards are so beautiful. They deserve to be behind frames as well, I think.
Thank you.
And a lot of people do. And that, our cards are 5x7, and they fit perfectly into a 5x7 frame, or you could mat it and put it into a larger frame.
Right. Well, they're really lovely. And again, it has a kind of a sentimental quality and artistic quality all at the same time. I want to talk a little bit about how people can find this, and then we want to give people at home an idea how they might be able to try their own hand at pressing flowers. So where do people, if they are just want to access your work, how do they do that, Andy?
Well, we have a website. It mm-hmm. is, I'll give it to you, it's flatflowercards.etsy, which is spelled ETSY.com.
Okay. All right, I'm sure we'll put that up on the screen for okay. folks, and so they can find you there. And I know that you also participate in some of the local shows around
right.
town.
We've participated in the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center art show. They have one in March, and they also have one in December.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been doing those for many years, actually.
Yeah, I would imagine that'd be a great audience for you.
It really is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, lots of people who are very enthusiastic about the botanicals there.
Yeah.
And so let's talk a little bit now about, for those folks at home who might be interested in trying to do this, are there a lot of special supplies needed? And, you know, I find a four-leaf clover in a Bible, and I think somebody just put that in there and closed it up. But mm-hmm. if they really want to get the beautiful results that you do, mm-hmm. Do they need to buy special things? Is there a press?
You don't need a press. We use phone books. And mm-hmm. we find that the absorbency
okay.
of the cheap paper in phone books works perfectly. You can get a lot of weight out of it, the phone book itself, and then we put other heavy books on top. And depending on the plant you use will depend on how many days it takes for it to dry out.
Okay.
But key is to try and pick your plant when it's already fairly dry, preferably not early morning because the dew is still on the plant. If you can pick it later and it's already dry and you put it in the phone book, you'll have better luck.
Okay, so cut the flower later in the day after mm-hmm. the dew's dried off.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do about, you know, now I've seen some of your images and we'll be showing lots of them as we go through, but some of the flowers, you know, like roses, which are really kind of, I would have a hard time picturing how you flatten a rose. How mm-hmm. do you achieve that?
You pretty much have to, you manipulate some of the flowers a lot. And you mm-hmm. hate to admit that you manipulate Mother Nature, but sometimes we do.
Well, it's all for a good cause.
a full triple double rose, probably you don't even want to attempt that.
Right.
But some of the knockout rose or single roses, like a mutabilis rose, presses very nicely.
Mm-hmm.
And we have found, we've come across many things that we've tried to press, hoping they'll come out nicely, and they just won't. So,
sure.
You know,
some turn a deep red flower will turn black.
Mm.
So we avoid deep red flowers. a lot of them will change color, but it's okay. For example, you have a picture of the rock rose there.
All right,
That rock rose is more pink. Mm-hmm. On the plant, but once it's pressed, it turns a little bit lavender.
Yeah, and this also illustrates something different. You're beginning to put into some of the cards, not all, some figures. Mm-hmm. In this case, a kitten that looks like a kitten who's running around my courtyard right now. Very nice products, cards, beautifully decorated. Let's continue the step a little bit.
Okay.
If people want to arrange them in the way that you have, do you actually glue these into place? What kind of glue do you use?
Depending on the flower, that will determine your choice of glue.
Mm.
For most of them, we use a 3M spray glue.
I see.
And it's the lightest glue. It's
okay.
Called Spray Mount.
Okay.
And it's a very misty glue. They have, a 3M puts out one called number 75, and that's good for stems or more bulky pieces. It'll glue them down tighter.
Okay.
But mostly we use just the Spray Mount glue.
Okay.
And then we use a paste glue for a lot of flowers that you want to glue on individually. Because mm-hmm. sometimes we'll take a flower apart and reassemble it on the page, and I use a paste glue called Yes.
Okay. Now, once again, I want to make sure people understand how to be in touch. I've seen your cards at Book People, and I know that they're available in other places here in town. But if they just want to see the whole assortment, they go, what's the website one more time?
It's called flatflowercards.etsy.com.
All right. Well, thank you both very much for being our guests once again on Central Texas Gardener. Good luck to you, and thanks for being here.
Thank you. It's been our pleasure.
All right. And coming up next, it's our friend Daphne Richards.
Hi, and welcome to Down to Earth. I want to thank our viewers. You've been sending in some great questions, and we have another one this week from Melissa. Her larkspurs and other wildflowers tended to wilt and just keel over this past spring, even when she was watering them. While this is a very common problem in spring when our temperatures start to heat up, it can be very confusing. When you see your plants wilting, you water them. But the plants actually are wilting from the heat, so they don't need any water. But we think they do, so we water, and we water, and we water, and we cause those plants to rot and keel over. When you pull them from the ground, you'll notice that they have a very smart root system that may even look a little bit mushy. It's a common problem in plants allowed to grow wild in your landscape, or to establish from seed in a very big thicket, so they're very close together. They're heavily planted. And since they're so close together, there's very little air movement, which inhibits the water from evaporating from the soil, which is great, but that means you don't need to water them so much. So resist watering them if you've just watered them. If you watered them yesterday and they're wilty the next day, then they don't need any water. Just watch for it happening in the afternoon because it is due to the heat. So be aware of your soil and keep track of that watering. This is extremely unlikely that the plants would need water if you've just watered them. Our plant this week is bat-faced Kufia, Kufia labia. The Flamenco series has a very nice deep flower. This plant is native to tropical Mexico, so it may be an annual here for us. It's only hardy to 10 degrees. And last winter, we may have lost a lot of those if you had them in your garden. It does need to be planted in full sun, but it can also take partial shade. As the common name suggests, the flowers look like little bat faces. It has two upper petals that look like little ears, and those petals are red to a deep purple color with darker purple centers. The Flamenco series is a common new cultivar with bolder, larger flowers. This is a very drought-tolerant plant, so it's great in xeriscapes, but it does need some water, so you will need to water it regularly. It's easily prone to root rot, so don't overwater it, especially if you live in areas with heavier clay soils, as many of us do. The flowers are tubular, so it does attract hummingbirds, making it a very attractive addition to our gardens. It adds an interesting and unique element to any garden bed with those unique flowers. It looks great paired with yellow flowering plants. It grows to about 2 feet tall and up to 3 feet wide, so give it lots of space. It is evergreen, and it does bloom repeatedly from the spring all the way through the summer and often into the fall. To do in your garden this week, you want to keep an eye out for chinch bugs since we're getting much warmer. These are common in sunny areas of your lawn, and they do love the heat, so they're common out near the hotter areas near the street. The symptoms are large brown patches, which can make this easily confusing with brown patch or grubworm damage. You determine whether you have chinch bugs by using a milk jug, cutting off both ends and pressing that into the soil. Fill that area with some soapy water and watch for those insects to jump around or float to the surface. These bugs are resistant to chemical treatment, but products with bifenthrin and acephate work best. Natural methods really are not effective, but you can hopefully prevent this problem if you keep your grass well watered to lower the heat in the areas where you have seen problems in the past. For more information on this problem, contact your local Office of Extension Service. We'd love to hear from you, so visit klru.org/CTG to send us your question or plant of the week from your garden.
Thanks, Daphne. Now let's check in with Trisha Shirey for Backyard Basics.
Everyone loves fresh, ripe tomatoes from the garden, but diseases with tomatoes can be very challenging. Now, in order to prevent your plants from getting diseases, you want them to be as healthy as possible, and that starts with choosing disease-free transplants that have been protected from early cold spells by the nurseries and also in your garden. Plant your tomatoes in full sun or give them at least 6 hours of sunlight. Plants grown in less light will tend to have more disease problems or fail to bloom. Be careful with your young plants. Some diseases can enter damaged areas of the plants and then kill them. Trim off lower leaves so they're not in contact with the soil when you plant, and cage your plants early to avoid plant damage. If you're trying to cram a tomato plant into a cage once it's grown a little bit, you're going to end up breaking some stems and leaves. Cage plants have better air circulation and will have fewer disease problems than plants that are allowed to sprawl on the ground. Space your plants so that they have good air circulation between them, at least 3 to 4 feet apart on some of the larger indeterminate varieties of tomatoes. Control insects on your plants. Cucumber beetles can spread bacterial wilt. Aphids and other insects can transmit many diseases to your plants. Avoid picking your fruit or working around plants when the foliage is wet, whether it's rained or whether you've watered. And this is also important with cucumbers and beets. You can spread diseases that way. Also, if you smoke, you want to wash your hands after you've smoked a cigarette or a cigar, because you can actually transmit tobacco mosaic virus to your plants. Rotate your crops, including other members of the nightshade family like peppers, potatoes, and eggplant. Spores of diseases like southern blight can survive in our soils for several years, so a 3-year rotation of these plants is best. Clean your tomato cages or whatever you're using for support after use. You can use a bleach solution, an alcohol spray, or other disinfectant, and remove all ties and twine that are attached to the cages. And also, at the end of the season, remove all plant debris. Get up any leaves and stems. As long as they're not diseased, you can put them in the compost pile, but just make sure you clean up the garden well. Avoid over-fertilizing plants. Fertilizer burn can resemble plant disease. Sometimes you'll have yellowing of lower leaves that then turn brown, small leaves, sometimes the edges of the leaves just look a little bit brown and burned on the tips. If you have plants that are yellowing or have very small leaves or stunted growth or slow-growing plants, that can indicate a nitrogen deficiency, so you may need to add nitrogen. Control weeds near your plants, especially members of the nightshade family. Insects can carry diseases from those weeds to crops in the garden. Also important to minimize wetting of the leaves. Drip irrigation decreases disease problems by keeping soil off the leaves of plants. Mulching around your plants also will protect them from drying out and prevent water from splashing up on the leaves, but don't mulch too close to the stem. And you may have to reapply mulch during the growing season because it does break down in the sunlight. If you see leaves that are affected by disease that look bad, just make sure you cut those off as soon as possible and discard them. Don't put them in the compost pile. Wash your hands and shears before you move to other plants. If your plant is cut, this is what a healthy tomato stem looks like. It has very white tissue inside. If you cut a plant that looks diseased,
You'll notice that the inside of the vascular tissue is brown or tan. So that shows that the vascular system has been affected, and you just need to pull that plant out if it's been severely affected. Bag it up and dispose of it. Don't put it in your compost. If damage to your plant is very severe, summer is an excellent time to solarize your soil to control fusarium and other soil-borne diseases. Wet your soil, cover it with a 6 milliliter layer of clear plastic, weight it on the sides for 4 to 6 weeks, and that will help to kill a lot of the diseases that would cause problems for future gardens. Water well, add compost and molasses to bring the soil back. If you've got disease problems, you can treat your plants with compost tea or a horticultural cornmeal tea. And there's also a great product, Serenade. It's Bacillus subtilis. It's a soil-dwelling bacterium that controls anthracnose, bacterial leaf spot, early and late blights, powdery mildew, and many other diseases. Use it early at the first signs of problems, and you can control diseases in your plants and have a great harvest of tomatoes.
Visit klru.org/CTG to watch online and get more tips. Next week, meet author Amy Stewart and her wicked plants. Until then, I'll see you in the garden.
There's something new blooming online. Central Texas Gardener has a new website with an improved search, tons of gardening resources, and video. When you're not in the garden, head to klru.org/CTG. To learn about today's program, watch online, and follow CTG's blog, check out klru.org/CTG.